Hello students, welcome to the 8th lecture of software engineering, and today we are going to discuss project scheduling and project scheduling tools. So let's see what we have discussed till now. In 7th lecture we have seen estimation for software projects, okay, in which we have seen how to calculate line of codes, function count, and we discussed about the Kokomo models, all these things. And chapter is software project management, which we are discussing. And in this chapter we have discussed three things, that is project management concepts, then we discussed software measurement and matrices and estimation for software projects. Now we will discuss these two things. These two things are remaining in software engineering syllabus, and today we will discuss this topic, that is project scheduling. So till now, okay, this is one of the important chapters for the exam perspective. Most of the questions are being asked from this chapter itself. And then mostly asked from the estimation of project and project scheduling and software measurement and matrices. So let's overview the lecture which we are going to discuss today. Today we are going to discuss project scheduling and all the concepts related to project scheduling we are going to discuss today. And what is the outline? First we'll see overview of scheduling, why we want to schedule the project and what is the need of scheduling. Then we will see why project scheduling is important, and if we do not schedule a project, what will happen. Then we will see the basic concepts of scheduling, what are the activities involved in scheduling. Then we will see objectives of project scheduling. Then we will discuss project scheduling process. Okay, this is important part, project scheduling process, in which we divide the process, complete project into activities. Then we plan the activities accordingly. Then we will see project scheduling tools. We have some interesting tools for project scheduling, like Gantt chart, activity network. All these things we will discuss in this chapter. Okay, then we will see the PERT and CPM approach for project scheduling. Okay, so critical path method is being asked most of the time in the exams, so we will see this in details. Okay, then we will see how we can track the project schedules. Okay, because we are scheduling a project, and in the project management we want to track the progress of the report, how much of the project, how much we have completed till now, and what is the deadline, are we missing the deadline or we are going according to the deadline. All these things we will see in scheduling. Okay, how to catch up the deadline and how to plan the activities such that we can easily catch the deadline and does not go beyond the deadline. Okay, all these things we will see in this, and in last we will see summary of the lecture. So the objective of this lecture is to introduce software project management and to describe its distinctive characteristics, and to discuss project planning and the planning process. Okay, then you will see how to represent the planning graphically. Okay, to show how graphical schedule representation are used by project management. Then you will see to discuss the notations of risk and risk management processes. So till now we have seen that in first lecture we have seen some process models like waterfall model, spiral model, or prototyping model, iterative models, all these models. Okay, so now what we will do is, because we have reached at the end of the course of the software engineering, so now we will connect the dots. We will see how we can connect all these things. First we studied about the basics of software engineering, then we have seen the software development models, then we saw how requirements are gathered, then we see how to manage the process, how to manage the project. So now we will connect all these dots. Okay, we have selected a process model to develop a software, then we have identified what are the tasks involved in developing a pro software. Like if you have selected waterfall model for developing your software, then what are the tasks involved in this? Okay, tasks are software requirement gathering, then feasibility study, then design, coding, and all these things, all these phases are the task in a software engineering. Okay, so we have identified the task which will be performed to complete a software. Then we have estimated the resource required to complete this project. Okay, we have seen what are the resources, like time, people, tools, all these things we have seen how to calculate this. Okay, in third chapter we have calculated the matrices values, like line of codes, effort, people, production, productivity, duration, line of or document lines, all these matrices we have seen till now. Okay, now we will connect all these things, why we selected a model, then why we have so many activities in a model, then why we need to calculate the matrices like line of code or function count in advance before starting the project. Now what we will do is we will connect these dots. That is, you have to create a network of software engineering tasks that will enable you to get the job done on the time. Okay, you will have some task or activities to complete a project. Okay, what we will do is now we have a project, and from this project we will divide this project into the activities, and then activities are defined with the completion time, start time, and what are the resources to be allocated to an activity. Like this we will go activity wise. Okay, so we will divide complete project into activities, then we will assign the resources to activities. Okay, so once the network is created, you have to assign responsibility for each task, make sure it gets done, and adopt the network as risk become reality. So after dividing your project into activities, what you will do is you will assign this activity to a concerned person. For example, first activity is requirement analysis, so you will assign this activity to analyst. Okay, for example, second activity is design of the software, designing. So software architect is the person for designing the software. Okay, then you will have coding activity, so developer or coder is the person, concerned person, who will handle the coding of the software. Like this you will divide the software into activities, and then you will assign the persons to these activities. Okay, so what are the objectives of project scheduling? First objective is completing the project as early as possible by determining the earliest start time and finish of the each activity. So with each activity we have allocated the start time and finish time. So we will have some activities which will depend on each other, which means that we cannot start one activity before completing the previous activity. For example, we have coding activity, and before coding we do designing. Okay, designing activity cannot be done without requirement analysis. Like these activities are related to each other, they cannot go parallelly. Okay, they have to be done in serial. First we will do requirement analysis, then we will do designing, then we will do coding. So like this, to each activity we will assign the start time and finish time, and like this we will assign some resources to each activity like person and time. Then calculating the likelihood a project will complete it within a certain time of period. Okay, so whenever you have a project, with the project we have a deadline associated. Okay, either deadline is given by the client, or you decide the deadline by calculating the time required to each activity. Okay, so deadline can be decided by you, that is developer, or by the client. So then after deciding the deadline, you will see what is the probability that I can complete this project within the given time. Okay, then finding the minimum cost schedule needed to complete the project by a certain date. Okay, investigating the results of possible delays in activities completion time. Okay, so it is not sure that whatever time we are giving to activity we can finish in this time. Okay, any activity can take more time or less time. It is possible to vary the timing of activity completion and starting timing. If one dependent task is completing lately, then next task which is dependent on this task will surely start lately. Okay, for example, your assigned time to design activity was 10 days, but designing completed in 15 days. So the starting time of the coding will also vary. Okay, starting will also be delayed. So smoothing out resource allocation over the duration of the project. So with scheduling, what you can do is you can also schedule the resources. At what time, what resources should be given to which person or which activity. Okay, like this you can schedule the resources also when you are scheduling the project. In order to build a complex system, many software engineering tasks occur in parallel. Okay, it is possible that we can have multiple tasks in parallel. Okay, the result of work performed during one task may have a profound effect on work to be conducted in another task. For example, if you change the design of a module, you have to change the coding also. Okay, if you are using a different algorithm, then you have to change the coding of this part. Okay, like this, some activities are dependent on each other. Coding activity is dependent on design activity. Okay, So like this, design activity and coding activity can also go in parallel. How? Let's say you have divided a software into parts. Then what you can do is you can design a part, and in parallel you can design a part, and can after completing the designing of an activity, you can do the coding of this part. When you are doing the coding for first component, what you can do is in parallel, in designing phase, the person who is concerned with designing can design the second module. When this person complete the designing of second module, the person who is concerned with coding can start the coding of this second module. Like this, these activities can go like pipelining, okay, like in the pipelining. But before ending the designing phase, you cannot start the coding phase. It's also virtually impossible to assess progress on a moderate or large software project without a detailed schedule. Okay, we require a schedule to actually handle a large project. So scheduling is required. Why? What is the need of scheduling? Because we have seen a lot of late delivery in software. Software industry is suffering from the late delivery of softwares. That's why a concept of project scheduling came into picture. And what are the reasons of late software delivery? We have some real reasons why softwares are delivered lately. An unrealistic deadline established by someone outside the software development group and forced on managers and practitioners within the group. So what happens is client does not know what time the software is going to take. Okay, for example, he does not know your software, how complex software you are demanding, and he is deciding the deadline. Okay, whenever client decide the deadline without the prior information of the product which is demanding, then it will be an unrealistic deadline. Okay, most of the time it will be an unrealistic deadline. So deciding the deadline, this should be the work of the development team. Okay, so development team should do all the evaluations, like how much time each activity will take and how time can vary. According to that, they should decide the deadline, not the person who does not know anything about the project. Okay. So if any person decides about the deadline and he does not know anything about the development process and what happens in developing a software, then he will, most of the time, he will decide an unrealistic deadline. Then sometimes it happens that customers' requirements changes when we are actually developing the project. When software development is in progress, customer requirement may change. So if customer requirement is changing, then you have to schedule the changes also. Okay, you have to reflect this change into the schedule also. So if you are not changing the schedule according to the requirements, what will happen is you will miss the deadline. Okay, now project is becoming big because now you have to add more functionalities, but you have kept the same schedule. So in this case, what will happen is your schedule will go beyond the time. Okay, which means it will miss the deadline. An honest underestimate of the amount of effort and number of resources that will be required to do the job. Okay, it is possible that you can underestimate the resource required for a particular project. If you are doing the underestimation of the resources, then it will happen that you will miss the resources. For example, you are underestimating the number of people required to complete a project. Okay, a project should be 10 people should be assigned to a project, but you are assigning 5 people. So what will happen? The project will take more time. In software development process, lot of risks are involved. If you ignore the risk, it is possible that your software may go beyond the deadline, or there will be a lot of problems if you ignore the risk. Okay, risks are definitely involved in everything. In software development process, we have some risk and we have to take care of those also. Technical difficulties that could not have been foreseen in advance. Okay, it is possible that the software tools which are available will not be enough for developing the particular software. So it is possible that technical difficulties can also come. Human difficulties that could not have been foreseen in advance. Miscommunication among project staff and results in delay. So it is possible that due to miscommunication between the project staff or like in team, it is possible that you can delay your software. A failure by project management to recognize that the project is falling behind schedule and a lack of action to correct the problem. So what should we do if we have an unrealistic deadline? Okay, we cannot just go to the customer and say that this is an unrealistic deadline and you need to increase the time. Okay, you need to give us more time. So you cannot just say like this, or you cannot say like we cannot complete this project in this time. What you need to do is you need to do particular, you need to first you need to do a particular research why this deadline is unrealistic. You need to show them in on papers, you need to tell them the reason why your deadline is unrealistic. If deadline is unrealistic, what you can do, what you can suggest them to meet the deadline, and also project should also go smoothly. So what you need to do is, if you know that the deadline is unrealistic, what you can do, perform a detailed estimate using historical data from past projects. Take the past projects and see why this project will take more time. Okay, give the reason using the past projects. Determine the estimate effort and duration for the project. Okay, effort estimation and duration estimation can be done before starting a project with the help of those projects which you have already developed. Okay, past projects. Using an incremental process model, develop a software engineering strategy that will deliver critical functionality by the imposed deadline. What you can do is, if you know that the deadline is unrealistic, you can deliver the software in parts. Okay, let's say your software should be completed in 12 months. So what you can do is, after every 3 months, you can deliver a particular functionality of a software. Complete software is not delivered at once. What you will do is, you will keep developing the software and will keep delivering the software. Okay, as we have seen incremental software process model, we have studied incremental process model, in which what we do is, we develop the software in parts, and after developing each version of the software, we keep delivering it. Okay, so user can use the software before the deadline, but he will not be able to use the complete software. He will be able to use only a particular part of the software. Meet with the customer and, using the detailed estimate which you have done till now, explain why imposed deadline is unrealistic. Okay, you have to give a solid reason with a proof why your deadline is unrealistic. So be certain to note that all estimates are based on performance on past project. Okay, you cannot just imagine and say and write them that this deadline is unrealistic. You have to estimate the deadline according to the past projects. You have to estimate the time required and resources required according to those projects which you have already completed. Okay. Also be certain to indicate the percent improvement that would be required to achieve the deadlines as it currently exists. So now let's come to the project scheduling. Actual project scheduling, what happens in scheduling? First phase is compartmentalization. In compartmentalization, what we do is, the product and process must be decomposed into a manageable number of activities and tasks. Okay, so what we do is, first we divide the product and process to develop a software into the task. For example, we can divide a software process into the tasks according to the process model we have chosen. For example, you are choosing waterfall model, then you will divide the process into 7 parts, like first is your problem statement, then requirement analysis, feasibility study, designing, coding, like this. These are the activities. Interdependency. Tasks that can be completed in parallel must be separated from those that must be completed serially. So if you do not separate the task which can be completed in parallel and which can be done in serial, then what will happen is, you will end up doing those tasks which can be done in parallel, you will be ending them doing in serial. So it will take more time. So if six tasks can be done in parallel in one day, it will take one day. Okay, if you do not identify which task can be done in parallel and which can be done in serial, so you will end up doing all the tasks in serial. So it will take more time. Time allocation, then now you have identified the tasks of a process or your product. What are the tasks or activities you have to do to complete this project? Now after identifying the tasks, what you need to do is, you need to allocate the time to each activity. You will allocate the start time, earliest start time, or earliest finish time, like this. All these times will be given to activity. Okay, and how much time this task will take, and when this task will start, and when this task will end, like all these times are allocated to a particular task. Effort validation. Project manager must ensure that on any given day there are enough staff members assigned to completed the task within the time estimated in the project plan. So you know that you need to complete this project in this given deadline. So this is the responsibility of project manager to ensure that on a given day number of person which are required to complete a task should be there. Okay, so effort is calculated in person months, or you can, if you are talking about daily life, then you can say in person days. So on each day, number of person or number of staff should be available to do a particular task. Defined responsibilities, which means every schedule needs to be assigned to a specific team member. As I have given example, like for doing the requirement analysis, this task should be given to analyst, and for doing the coding, this task should be given to coders or developers. Like all the activities have some concerned persons and team members to which we will give all these things. Defined outcomes. Every task in this schedule needs to have a defined outcome, and we will decide what will be the outcome of this task, what will be the deliverable by this task. For example, in requirement analysis, deliverable is SRS document. So these are the outcomes of different activities. So we have to define the outcomes of each activity. Defined milestones. A milestone is accomplished when one or more work product from an engineering task have passed quality review. Okay, so we will reach the milestone when the verification is done of your task and all the outcomes and all the deliverables have been verified. For example, these are the activities and milestones. You have first activity, that is feasibility study, and from the feasibility study we get the feasibility report, and from the requirement analysis we get the SRS document. Okay, and from the prototype development we get the evaluation report. From design, we will get the architectural design, which is done by software architect. And requirement specification, we get the software requirement specification document. So these are the milestones achieved on these activities. Okay, so these are the activities, and given milestones are these for these activities. So what is the process and what are the steps in project scheduling? What we do when we start scheduling the process? We have a particular, if we are studying the software engineering, and for doing everything we have an engineering approach, which means we have a predefined professional process for doing a particular task. For example, if you are doing the scheduling, so you will have a particular number of steps in which you will do the scheduling of a software. First one is split project into task and estimate the time and resource required to complete each task. Okay, so divide the complete product into task and assign the time and resources required to complete this task. Organize tasks concurrently to make optimal use of workforce. So what you need to do is to meet the deadline or to complete the project till deadline. What you need to do is you need to identify what tasks can be done in parallel. Okay, as we have discussed earlier, minimize task dependencies to avoid delays caused by one task waiting for another to complete. So it is possible that one task can, let's say for example, we have a task A, and then we have a task B and C. Like this we have task A, B, C, D. So B is dependent on A, C is dependent on A, and D is dependent on A. And with each activity we have start time and finish time, like this. Okay, so start time for first activity is 0 and finish time is the time which will be required to complete this activity. Okay, so if this starting time for second activity is the time at which this activity will finish, because we can start this activity only after completion of this activity. Okay, D can be started after the completion of A. If A fails, or for example A delays by 10, then this will also, the starting time of this will also increase by plus 10. So whatever delays comes in first activity, this delay will be reflected on the activity which is dependent on this activity. So minimize the task dependencies to avoid delays caused by one task waiting for another to complete. Dependent on project manager's intuition and experience. Okay, so this is the process. First, what we do is we identify the activities, then identify activity dependencies, and we will draw a graph from this activity which will be called dependency graph. Then we will see for each activity, we will see what are the resources required for each activity, then allocate the people to activities. For example, giving the different phases are assigned to different people in the team. Then create the project chart. Okay, in this we will see what are the bar chart and Gantt charts. What are the activities? Task required to complete a project are called the activities. Okay, activity is a small entity and tasks are called activities. Estimated completion time are associated with each activity. With each activity we will have completion time. Each activity completion time is related to the amount of resource committed to it. Okay, so if we have less number of resources for one activity, then it will take more time. Okay, if we have more number of resources for an activity, then it will take less time. For example, activity A requires 10 days to complete with 2 people. So if you increase the number of people, what will happen is time will decrease, completion time will decrease. So like this sentence is saying activity completion time is related to the amount of resources committed to it. The degree of activity details depends on the application and the level of specificity of data. To determine optimal schedule, we need to identify all the project activities. Okay, this is one of the important part of scheduling a process. To schedule a process, first you need to divide into activities and you need to clearly identify what are the activities required to achieve a particular milestone. Okay, so you have to clearly declare what are the activities required to complete this product. Determine the precedence relation among activities. Precedence relation means which activity is related on which activity. Okay, which activity is parent of which activity. So all these dependencies need to be determined. Based on this information, we can develop managerial tools for project control. We will see what are the managerial tools. We have some tools for project scheduling. So we have some scheduling tools. What are these tools? We have activity networks. We will see what is activity network through an example. Task network or activity network are graphical representation that can be of the task interdependencies and can help define a rough schedule for particular project. Scheduling tools should be used to schedule any non-trivial project. Then we have approach which is called PERT, program evaluation and review technique. And then we have critical path method, that is CPM. We will see these two methods with an example. Are equivalent techniques that allow software planner to identify the chain of dependent tasks in the project work breakdown structure that determine the project duration time. So these two methods are used to find the dependencies in number of tasks. Then timeline, or we can say Gantt chart. We have seen operating system, what are the Gantt charts. They are related to task and time. So Gantt chart enables software planner to determine what task will be needed to be conducted at a given point in time. So let's say in operating system we have seen this kind of Gantt chart in which in this direction we have time and then we have processes like this. P1 will complete at time and this is the starting time of a process and this is the finish time of the process. Then we have burst time. Burst time which means what is the time required to complete this process. Like this in activity. From these activities, we will design a Gantt chart. We will tell us at what time the project will complete. Okay, this will be the project completion time at the end. The best indicator of progress is the completion and successful review of a defined software product. So now we will see an example of these tools, how we can use these tools to schedule a particular project. So for example, we have an example of a company that is ABC Computers, and ABC Computers manufactures personal computers. So we will see from the starting how we can schedule the task and how we can schedule the project from this example. It is about to design, manufacture and market. So they have three activities. First they design the personal computer, then they manufacture it, then they market. So the ABC Palm 2000 and Palm Book computers, they design these two computers. And they will have some time associated with design, manufacturing and marketing. So there are three major tasks to perform, that is manufacture the new computer, train staff and vendor representatives. Okay, you will have to train the staffs and vendors, then advertise the new computers. So you will be having the training for users and developers of the computer. And after completion of the manufacturing process, what you will do is you will advertise the new computer. So ABC needs to develop a precedence relation chart. So how they will do that? The chart gives a concise set of tasks and their immediate predecessors. What are the activities required before starting an activity? So this is the description of activities required for ABC computers to design, manufacture and advertise a particular computer. So they are designing some computers, personal computers. So first is manufacturing activity. In this, what way they will do is, first activities, they will design the prototype. Okay, what will be the prototype of my computer? What are the things I am going to include in my computer, in my personal computer? All these things will be included in a prototype. Then they will purchase the material required to manufacture a personal computer. For example, he will purchase hard disks and let's say motherboard and let's say DVD-ROM. And RAM is all these things will be purchased. Then manufacture of prototype model. You have designed a prototyping model, then you have your material. Then what you can do is you can use the prototype to design the or manufacture the particular personal computer. After manufacturing the computer according to prototype model, what you can do is you can revise for optimization. You can revise your design for optimization. Can you make any optimization in your design? Then initial production, then staff training. These are the activities: manufacturing activities, then training activities, then advertising. So what we are doing is we are designing the computer, then we are manufacturing the computer, then training the staff for using the computer and for doing the marketing of the computer. Then we are doing the advertising, and advertising activities are pre-production advertising and post-design advertising. So from the activity description chart, we can determine immediate predecessor for each activity. For example, activity B cannot be started before completing the activity A. Activity A is an immediate predecessor of activity B because it must be completed just prior to the commencement of B. So activity is an immediate predecessor. Okay, this is predecessor and this is successor. So activity B cannot be started before finishing the activity A. So like this, we will generate the activity description chart from the set of activities.